A very warm hello and welcome. This is Chaiti, Narula with all the latest on this week's episode of Shades of India. Let's start off this week's episode with the top story making headlines here in India. A major political war has erupted over the legacy of India's Iron Man, Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel. The BJP has pushed to claim the image of the great uniter, pitting his nationalism mantle against Nehru politics. The BJP has accused the Congress of sidelining the great leader, but the Congress says that Patel is theirs, saying that the BJP is twisting history for politics. Big questions come up whether the Nehru-Gandhis deliberately ignored Patel's vital contribution to shaping India. Was Patel's grand legacy deliberately set to glorify one family?
स्वीकृति दे या ना दे कोई राजनीतिक दल उनके महात्मा को स्वीकार करे या ना करे लेकिन यह देश इस देश की युवा पीढ़ी भी एक पल के लिए भी सरदार साहब को भूलने के लिए तैयार नहीं है.
Tributes to an icon of independent India as Prime Minister Modi flagged off the run for unity in the capital. In almost glaring contrast, Sardar Patel's 142nd birth anniversary took some precedence over the 33rd anniversary of the assassination of former Prime Minister Indira Gandhi that sparked the horrific anti-Sikh riots. And screaming out again is the age-old BJP-Congress war of words over appropriating Patel's legacy, being pitched directly against the preeminence granted to the Nehru Gandhi family.
इतिहास के जरोखे से इस महापुरुष के नाम को या तो मिटा देने का प्रयास हुआ या तो उसको छोटा करने का प्रयास हुआ.
कांग्रेस के वो मेंबर थे, बहुत इंपॉर्टेंट मेंबर थे, नेहरू जी के बिल्कुल निकट थे. और तो ये अब उसको ट्विस्ट करना और कोई खेलने की जरूरत, तो जो उस इतिहास को जानते हैं या पढ़ते हैं वो गुमराह नहीं होंगे भले ही और हो जाए.
Patel's brilliance being forced to a back seat by Nehru and later by his successors is an age old BJP flogging horse.
सरदार पटेल अगर जिंदा होते तो कश्मीर की समस्या का समाधान कब का हो गया होता. और सरदार पटेल ने नेहरू को कई बार चिताया था कि चीन से सावधान रहना चाहिए, लेकिन नेहरू ने कभी इस बात पर ध्यान नहीं दिया.
The BJP bases its owning the Patel legacy on his muscular brand of politics, a direct counter to the softer Nehruvian approach. Besides Patel's contribution to creating a united India, that takes on an added dimension for the BJP in poll-bound Gujarat, Patel's home state, with the claim that Congress down the years sidelined Patel and instead promoted the Nehru Gandhis, linking it to the issue of Gujarati Asmita. The BJP claims Patel was sidelined, his legacy forgotten for decades as the Nehru Gandhis basked in eminence. As compared to multiple memorials for Nehru and Indira Gandhi in the capital, there are none except a statue for Patel. The Nehru Gandhis have named multiple government schemes after themselves. There are virtually none in Patel's name. The Bharat Ratna, India's highest civilian honour, came to Nehru and his family during their lifetimes. Patel got it 40 years after his death. Did the Nehru Gandhis deliberately ignore Patel's vital contribution to shaping India? Was Patel's grand legacy deliberately set aside to glorify one family?
Joining us now with a complete perspective on the story is my colleague Meghdoot. Meghdoot, first up, what are the allegations coming in accusing the Congress of sidelining Patel?
Yes, both the BJP as well as the Congress have been trying to usurp the legacy of Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel. The BJP alleges that the Congress did not give Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel his due. The Congress in turn says that the BJP is only trying to use the name of Sardar Patel for political gains.
And the Congress is now saying that Patel is there, saying that the BJP is twisting history. Give us a perspective on that as well.
Yes, Congress leaders have been taking pains to explain how Sardar Patel was made the first Home Minister of India, how the Congress did just about everything to ensure that Sardar Patel had his way in unifying the princely states. And the Congress says that Sardar Patel did get his due, his family definitely did get his due, and it's the BJP, in fact, that is trying to make political gains by using the name of Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel.
And what are your sources in the BJP saying at this point of time? Does the BJP feel that Patel's grand legacy was deliberately set aside to glorify one family? Is that the allegation that is coming in?
Yes, as far as the BJP is concerned, right down from the Prime Minister himself, there have been allegations from the BJP that the Congress was trying to undermine the power of Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel only just to ensure that one family did benefit out of it. He did say this, Prime Minister Narendra Modi did say this even while inaugurating, while dedicating the Sardar Sarovar Dam to the nation earlier this year, just a couple of months back. So as far as the BJP is concerned, it's made this allegation several times in the past that the Congress deliberately put down Sardar Vallabh Bhai Patel so that one family could benefit out of it.
It was barely an hour after the World Bank announced India's big jump in the ease of doing business rankings. Indeed, a very proud moment for all of us Indian and a very typical BJP versus the Congress face-off took off. Now, the Congress called it the seize of doing business over the ease of doing business. Adding greater momentum to this political fight is the electoral battle in Gujarat, where the state of the economy and issues like the impact of demonetization, the impact of GST have a very large role to play in which way the people vote. Congress Vice President Rahul Gandhi, who was in Gujarat, was on a lookout to cash in on just that. He immediately took a jibe against the government on the new rankings. The question now is, should an international ranking become the subject of domestic politics?
Arun Jaitley ji apne office mein baithte hain, bahar ke log jo kehte hain usko mante hain. Main unse vinti karta hu 5-10 minute kisi chote dukandar ke paas chale jaye, pura Hindustan chilla ke kahega, Hindustan mein ease of doing business.
On the campaign trail warpath in poll-bound Gujarat, Rahul Gandhi rubbishes the top 100 World Bank ranking for ease of doing business in India, terming the ease of doing business for a select few. Because economy achievements apart, it's the political ammunition use of the ease of doing business rankings that's actually making headlines.
The real situation is altogether different what World Bank report is suggesting. There is massive uneasiness amongst the traders, businessmen, shopkeepers down below.
And it's flying thick and hard from both sides. More from the high popularity Rahul tweets table, going sarcastically poetic this time. The office of Rahul Gandhi handled terms ease of doing business a self-satisfying idea. And the finance minister hits back. The UPA versus the NDA, ease of doing corruption versus ease of doing business, he tweets. As the ruling party pushes its old bungling, misfit Rahul argument.
Does Rahul Gandhi understand the implication of ease of doing business? Does he know it is not a BJP-sponsored or Government of India-sponsored event? It is a study undertaken by the World Bank?
Whether or not Rahul Gandhi's big political push hits home is one thing. It has to come back to the fact that a global success for India is being turned into a blatantly used political tool. Shouldn't economy successes recognized by the world be kept out of mudslinging domestic politics?
Pallavi, this is a very serious allegation by the Congress party, so much so that it compromises the country's achievement. How can a party, any political party for that matter, go on to question a World Bank report that announces such a big jump for India in the ease of doing business?
Well, you know, the Congress also has often cited international rankings when they wanted to defend their case when they were in power at the center as UPA 1 and UPA 2. What we really need to understand is that what's happening over here is not just a questioning of the world ranking, it's actually more politics which is being played out. But these rankings came just a day before Rahul Gandhi was to begin his three-day yatra in Gujarat. And, you know, at the core of his arguments or his election campaigns in this area has largely been focused on what he has called the lack of economic development. The fact is that the GST and demonetization has ensured that the benefits of the economy doesn't go down to the people. And he, in fact, talks about economic downturn. And when these figures came out, which actually put India at a very good status as far as the ease of doing business is concern, it was contradicting everything that Rahul Gandhi was talking about. So I'm certainly not surprised that the Congress has made this an issue, and in fact in doing so they have questioned already the rankings of a reputed agency. This certainly is led to some amount of discomfort within the Congress party, especially those who, you know, who deal with economic aspects of it, perhaps a former finance minister or prime minister as well, because as I said, many of them would often use these rankings to defend their case.
Pallavi, the Congress has called it the seas of doing business over the ease of doing business, even if they were referring to the MSMEs sector that are finding it difficult to sustain. Even the SMEs are finding it difficult to sustain. One must note that it is those businesses that were heavily cash dependent or were evading taxes that are finding it difficult to stay afloat. What is the Congress's take on why they think businesses are collapsing, contrary to what has been published by the World Bank?
In fact, interestingly, when Rahul was addressing the PhD Chamber of Commerce, he actually raised the issue of the small-scale industries, and he talked about the fact that they are the ones who have been hit the most. And it's over there that he spoke about the GST and the demonetization issue. And in fact, one important leg of his election campaign in Gujarat is Southern Gujarat, which is, you know, essentially the trader and the business belt. And this is this belt which really has been very pro-BJP, which the Prime Minister has always often nurtured, even when he was a chief minister. The argument which was given by Rahul Gandhi was that because of the high tax and because of a problem of tax compliance, it's the small traders, it's the small industries, the small scale industries which really have been hit. You know, they are the ones who are having to pay a huge amount of tax. They are not able to do it. You know, it's a very complicated procedure. And as I pointed out, there was an element of tax compliance, you know, and it is an arduous talk. For example, you know, recently when there was a meeting held within the AICC on the GST and demonetization issue, and you know, the opposition is planning to make this an issue on the 8th. The argument which was then given by them was simply this: what about small term traders, as how will they make a calculations of their GST or the tax concession is concerned?
Pallavi, would you call this a typical BJP versus Congress face off in the light of the Gujarat elections?
Yes, of course, it's a typical BJP versus Congress face-off. And as I was pointing out earlier, you know, the rankings came just a day before Rahul Gandhi was to begin his important leg of election campaign in Gujarat. And that was largely in southern Gujarat, which is essentially, you know, Surat, Valsad, Navsari. These are the belt of the textile industry or of the diamond merchants. So this is the trading community. This is the business community. There was certainly, you know, it wouldn't suit the Congress's cause or Rahul Gandhi's cause if he says that, you know, well, the rankings which have come of the ease of doing business is something which is, you know, it is true, because, you know, it is contradicting what he has been saying. And therefore, it became a face-off. And the moment Rahul Gandhi questioned these rankings, we saw very, very strong reactions really coming in from the BJP. There were a series of press conferences. The finance minister himself stepped in. You know, the prime minister congratulated the finance ministry, of course, issued several notifications and clarifications pointing out that why it actually meant. And not only that, the very next day, there was a huge surge as far as the Sensex was concerned. And that really was a thumbs up which was given by the markets, which doesn't, of course, suit the Congress party, but certainly does suit the government.
You know, it's evident that an international ranking has become the subject of domestic politics. How does the BJP react to this?
Well, the reaction from the BJP was predictable. They hit back at Rahul Gandhi and the Congress party, saying, you know, they should know what the ease of corruption is, because that's all that they have been doing when they have been in power for 10 years. So, you know, so if Rahul is questioning the ease of doing business figures, and, you know, the Congress party tried to prick holes in those figures, the fact that even a hunger index, India hasn't fared too well at all. And in fact, we have very abysmal figures coming in there. The BJP reacted by saying, "This look, these are the figures coming from an international you know, standing. And to question them is really not being politically and economically correct." And the fact is that India, in fact, the former Prime Minister, Dr. Manmohan Singh, who's an economist, always understood the value of these rankings, and he banked on them. So the BJP hit back at the Congress where it hurts it the most. And that is as far as the corruption issue is concerned. They said, first, Rahul doesn't understand the economy. Second, he is questioning international figures. Third, he is doing something which is not going to help India's image. And fourth, of course, is how would he know what economics is all about? Because all that they would do when they were in power was in corruption. And so ease of doing corruption, the ease of being corrupt, is a tagline, or the counter tagline, which has been given by the BJP.
All right, leave it at that. Thanks much, Pallavi, for joining us for more perspective on the story. Slipping into a very short break right here on Shades of India. When we return, more news from the world of entertainment follows. So stick around right here. Welcome back, and thank you so much for staying with us right here on Shades of India. Now for that weekly entertainment dose, Irrfan Khan in conversation with our entertainment editor Rajiv Masan on the recent scandal involving movie mogul Harvey Weinstein. Let's hear into that conversation.
Irrfan, you're amongst the very few Indian actors who successfully crossed over into Hollywood. How does the Harvey Weinstein scandal and the other scandals that have since emerged changed things in the movie business, you think? Or how will they change?
Things? I don't know whether it's going to change anything. Mm. You know, if the society... my concern is not about one individual. Right. Nothing is going to happen if you pinpoint at one individual and put all the blame onto him or her. Mm. I think it's the structure of the society. When you have a separation, sex, making love, is the most precious, gift nature has given to you. Now what happens, the society and everybody wants to control it because that's where your key is. And when you suppress it, it's bound to leak, it's bound to become distorted. People will find ways. If you have a matriarchal society where women have more power, you will see that, women are exploiting a man. And generally, it's a male-dominated society. The male, wherever they'll find an excuse, they are bound
to exercise their power.
Yeah.
You know, that incident and that issue has kind of thrown open the debate on sexual exploitation in the movie business here too. Is the glamour industry as a whole much more exploitative towards women? Also, Irrfan, you've struggled hard to break into the industry. There is this one very cynical but unfortunately very popular view that women themselves should be more careful about their circumstances. As someone who's seen the ruthless side of the film business, what are your thoughts on this?
Okay. See, let me tell you, this is not the only industry where this kind of exploitation happens. And exploitation happens, for sure. But there are people who use their sexuality to gain, power as well. You know, that's also a fact. So both the aspects are true. But it's sad that somebody has to go through it. And they cannot help themselves, or they feel helpless. That's a pathetic situation. But that's also true that male or female, they do use their sexuality to reach to some level.
We bring you yet another edition of Dress Dictionary, where we decode the dress code of your personal profession and discuss fashion and style tips tailor-made just for you. Have a look at this.
Today, we say hello to Kanupriya, an ex-journalist, the founder of a startup called Be Positive, and recently appointed head of marketing and communication at the National Commodities and Derivatives Exchange. Let's have a listen to what she has to say.
Hi, I'm Kanupriya Sehgal, and I'm very excited to be part of Dress Dictionary, the program that turns women into style icons. And I really need it at this moment because I'm walking a very thin line between running my own startup and working for a top company.
We start with the dress. Dresses are the easiest thing to put on before a hectic workday. And then you can dress them up or down accordingly with your choice of shoes or accessories. What I love about this dress is the color. It's pretty much all you need and makes a statement on its own. The sleeves are long, so they're good for office. They're conservative enough for office and they're perfect for this autumn season as well. What do you think?
Definitely, I think this is one of the most elegant dresses that I've worn because first, I like the color, I like the style, I like the cut. And the best part is, it's a good transition dress. So I can go to office in this, I can play with my baby in this. And similarly, I can add a nice accessory like this and go for a party in the evening. So I think this totally works for me.
She clearly said it all. Now on to look number two. Okay, Kanupriya, look number two. Tell me.
Well, Suhela, the thing is about this look, it has great colors. So these are exactly office colors. And the best part about these clothes is this minute detailing, which looks good. So when you walk into a meeting, you don't really shout out loud for attention, but you attract it all the same because it looks good.
Also, a slight mention here. Please take a look at the heels. These were picked specifically for her because she loves wearing heels to the office.
Absolutely, power dressing. Yes. So, when you're in heels, you have that additional advantage of height.
you look more powerful, and then you have these little things which bring out the femininity.
Right.
So you can easily rule the boardroom without really having to say a word.
Again, she said it all. Look number three it is. So this is power dressing. Now, as I've said many times before, I absolutely adore jumpsuits.
And you're looking very good in one yourself.
Thank you. This one in particular, in the all-white monotone look, I love. It looks great with different accessories. This jacket is perfect now that autumn is coming. So this is literally beekeeping to boardroom.
Absolutely. In fact, you know, this has an ethereal look to it. And as you know, I also have my startup around beekeeping. So nowadays when I go outside, there's a slight nip in the air. So this actually helps me get protected from the nip and also from the bees, because you know, there are bees all around. So we have to take care about that. So this is sort of a garment which protects my arms and everything from the bees. And I think the entire white look, white is a very corporate color.
Yeah.
So this is a different take on white altogether.
Yeah. So this is fashion, meet styles, meet comfort, just like you want it.
Totally, totally. So I must compliment you and thank you for, you know, letting me rediscover a totally different aspect of myself through these great dresses. I've learned quite a tip or two from your program.
It was absolutely our pleasure to have you. And with that, we end this week's Dress Dictionary. As always, I leave you with my style tip. Make improvements, not excuses. Seek respect, not attention. Thank you for watching. See you next time.
With that, it's a wrap from me, Chaiti Narula, on this week's episode of Shades of India. Thank you so much for tuning in. Thanks for your time.